think maybe do it next week, maybe we can go on paper.
This opportunity we have as Christian is the privilege of assembling ourselves the first day of the week to worship God. It's a great opportunity to worship our God and to assemble ourselves. And we'd like to thank God for his house, his tabernacle that he has provided for us to worship, for his extended family together with us. And I'd like to invite everyone to worship with us. We need not have to welcome ourselves, but we do have a visitor with us. Michael, thank you for reuniting yourself with the family. You're still a part of this family. So we want to begin with a prayer. First, we'd like to thank God for an opportunity and the privilege to worship him. Lord, we assemble ourselves, dear God, to acknowledge you as the God and Lord, the one and true God. Lord, and you know that we are your people, of your pastor, that you provide for us, dear Lord. You set a table before us, Lord. And Father, you lead us through the pastor, Lord, and you bring us to worship, Lord. As we gather ourselves together, may you bless each and every one. May you bless our leader. May you bless our pastor. And Lord, may you give us a word that will keep us through the week. In Jesus' name, amen.
We have a favorite that we haven't sung for a while. It's This Is God's House. So we're going to do that now. Let's stand and sing.
Welcome you here, enter with passion, enter with praise, walk through the doorway of grace. Sanctuary, this is where we come to see his face. This is God's house, God's place, where of us again, let's all worship him, let's all worship him, this is God's house.
house of the Lord. We're hungry and thirsty, that's why we came, when mercy is falling like rain. His sanctuary, this is where we come to seek His face. This is God's house, God's place, where everyone can find His grace. God's heart and God's hand touches each of us again. Let us worship Him. Let's all worship Him. This is God's house, God's place, where everyone can find His grace. God's heart and God's hand touches each of us again. Let's all worship Him. Let's all worship Him. This is God's house. This is God's house. This is God's house.
Amen.
Amen. While you're standing, let's read the verse of the month for July. Well, we've still got a couple of weeks. We have to repeat it and hopefully memorize it. How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of the messenger who announces peace, who brings good news, who announces salvation, who says to Zion, your God reigns. Let's say it one more time. How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of a messenger who announces peace, who brings good news, who announces salvation, who says to Zion, your God reigns. Isaiah 52, verse 7. Be seated. The announcements this week, I just stuck in my Bible behind me. Sorry about doing that. We have listed for today the Compassionate Ministries offering, but that is being postponed till next week, when perhaps we'll have a few more of our regular people back. Summertime is always a time of vacation, and so hopefully some of them will be back next week. So bring your take your offering home and bring it back next week. Tuesday at 6 p.m. the Board of Christian Education will meet. It's not in here, but just to let you know, Sister Shannon will be home tomorrow. Tomorrow night. We look forward to her being back. I know Pastor Bob does.
Yeah.
I don't know if her kids do, you know. His mom, you know.
They probably do.
But we're all looking forward to her coming back and seeing her next week. In fact, she'll be in the pulpit next week, won't she?
Yes, she will.
Yes. So Sister Shannon will be bringing our message next week. August 6th, the Pastor's Advisory Committee meeting will take place. The date for the Handcrafts Club for meeting for August is yet to be announced. The 22nd of August, the Church Council will meet. And September 24th, the youth group will once again commence their regular meetings.
You skipped one.
I did.
Tuesday, Board of Christian Education.
No, I said that.
Did you? All right, I didn't hear you.
That's okay. Yes, Tuesday, Board of Christian Education will meet. So don't forget, next Sunday, bring your offering for Compassionate Ministries. Our scripture reading this morning is from the book of Matthew, 13th chapter of Matthew. If you will stand, please, for the reading of his word. We'll be reading verses 1 through 9 and then 18 to 23. And again, if my words don't quite match what's up there, I'm reading from the Revised Standard Version, and I think that's from the New Revised Standard Version. The same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea. And great crowds gathered about him, so that he got into a boat and sat there. And the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seeds fell along the path, and the birds came and devoured them. Other seeds fell on rocky ground, for they had not much soil, and immediately they sprang up, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell upon thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. He who has ears, let him hear. And then beginning at verse 18 and reading through 23. Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in his heart. This is what was sown along the path. As for what was sown on rocky ground, this is he who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy, yet he has no root in himself, but endures for a while, and when tribulation or persecution arises on account of the word, immediately he falls away. As for what was sown among thorns, this is he who hears the word, but the care of the world and the delight in riches choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. And for what was sown on good soil, this is he who hears the word and understands it. He indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. God added his blessing to the reading of his holy word this morning.
Amen.
Because God so richly blesses us and gives willingly, we willingly give back to him as a thank you, and in order to grow his kingdom here on the earth, to minister to those who do not perhaps know him. So if the ushers would come forward. Thank you. us pray. Father, we do praise you and thank you so much for the many ways in which you blessed us. We return to you now these, our tithes and offerings, and pray that you would be blessed, that your kingdom would grow, and that in all things you would be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen.
At this time, we'd like to open up the service for praise report. I know the Lord has did something good for us this week. Many of you have been blessed. Or your family members have been blessed. You've received some healing touches. And this is a good time, a good opportunity and a privilege to share that because it's your testimony that inspire others. So, Pastor Bob.
We've been blessed to have a house guest this week. Visiting with the guys and enjoying himself, and we're glad to have been able to have that privilege. I'm a little bit blessed because I'm better than I was today than I was a week ago, and much better than 2 weeks ago, and I'm even more blessed because Shannon's coming home tomorrow.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. The song says, there ain't no sunshine since she's been gone. So our wives, when they go away and return, they bring sunshine and love to the house. And the father, he holds the fort down, he's the husband. He keeps everything band together, but the wives bring love. So thank God for wife, and we thank God that Shannon will be back to bring love and blessing to the house of the Beulahs. Praise God. And we're glad also, Pastor Bob, that you're feeling much better. And when you're well, we're well. And when you're ill, we're feeling the pain. So thank God that healing is taking place. All right, we have some more out there. Someone else like to share some of the blessings?
Yes. Okay. Actually, a couple of weeks ago, my wife asked for a prayer for one of my sisters. She had a biopsy, and we were concerned that she might have cancer. She does not.
Praise God.
She does not.
Praise the Lord.
She has other issues, however, she does not have cancer. And so we thank God for that.
Yes. That's always good news. Many families are being plagued by that awful, dreadful disease of cancer. And when we get news that one of God's children is free, and don't have that fear hanging over them, that shadow hanging over them, thank God for that. If anyone else would like to share? If not, are there, okay, Sister Pat.
My son's been back to work for 2 or 3 weeks and he's doing great.
Now all right. Okay, Pat's son is back to work. Work is hard, but it's good to have a job. And most of all, it's a blessing to be able to do that job. So thank God for that. God is in the blessing, he's in the healing business, and we serve a great God. Nothing too big for our God. Are there any unspoken requests? Okay, at this time we'll have a song and then we'll have our prayer.
We're going to sing now our prayer.
Thank you.
Let's bow our heads in prayer. Loving Father, gracious God, almighty God of the universe, Lord of Lord and King of Kings, Father, we honor you this morning, dear God. Lord, we assemble ourselves to worship you and give you praise. But Father, we also come to you asking and seeking, dear Lord, healing, dear God, guidance and leadership, dear Father. Father, we want you, dear God, to give us some guidance and understanding, Lord, of what it is, dear God, that we can do, dear God, to help our nation, dear God, in time of difficulties, dear Lord. Lord, there are difficulties, time facing our nation, dear God, but we have faith. Lord, you've given us hope in our Lord Jesus Christ, dear God. Father, you tell us to fear not, dear Lord. Lord, sometimes we trouble and despair, but we can turn to you for hope. We have a hope, dear Lord, and we thank you for this hope. Lord, we also want to share this hope with those who are hopeless, dear God. Those, dear Lord, who are distraught this morning, dear God, and many, dear God, who feel lost, who feel they have no direction. Lord, but you gave your son, Jesus, who's ever present, dear God, that we can turn to, dear Lord. Those that are downtrodden, those widows, dear God, that doesn't have a loved one's husband, Lord, those husbands that don't have wives, Father, that you're there for them. They need not be afraid. They can find comfort in you, dear Lord. Father, because you always keep your promise, and you promise that you will never leave us or forsake us. And Lord, we believe that today. Lord, we want to give you thanks, dear God, for our sister Pat's son, dear God, who has a job, has been able to return to the job, whom you have healed, dear God. And Lord, we pray for continued strengthening, continued healing, dear God, and Lord, continued restoration, dear God, to that son of Pat, dear Lord, that his life, dear God, will improve, the quality of that life will improve day by day, and Lord, that he will know that it is you, it is God, dear God, who made it all possible. And Lord, be able to give thanks, dear Lord. And Lord, bless his mother, dear God, who has continually prayed for him and stuck by his side. Father, we also want to continue to ask a blessing for our brother George Davis, dear Lord. Father, as he is in the veteran home, dear God, and Lord, there's no doubt there's time that he feels like he's being cast off and sometimes feel neglected. But Father, he know you as his Lord. And Father, we know that you will comfort him, dear God. And Lord, we ask that you bless his wife, Sister Faye, dear God, as she has her own difficulties, dear God, with a slight stroke. Lift her up, continue to heal her, continue to restore her, dear Lord. Father, hear our prayer, dear God, and we believe in you and trust in you, dear God, for restoration, Lord, and Lord, and hope, dear God, for that couple, Lord, who are grateful in our presence. Lord, we want to bless all the members that are not here today, dear Lord, as they travel abroad, Lord, to minister and to be witness among other members of your body, dear Lord. Bless our sister Shannon as she prepared to return, dear God. Give her safe travel, dear Lord. And we thank you for the blessing that she's been to her family, the blessing that her family has been to her, and the time of rest and restoration that she's received, that she will bring us a message next Sunday, dear God, that will bless our heart. Father, bless our pastor, Lord. We thank you for continued healing in his life, dear God. Lord, we know that he's your servant. We know that his main thrust in life is to be your servant and to do your will, and to preach your word, dear Lord, and to shepherd the flock that you have entrusted in his hand, Lord. We thank you, dear God, for that. And we pray that his health will be improved, that he will be healed, that he will continue to do the job that you call him to do. Lord, we thank you for that, Lord. And we thank you for everyone here this morning, Lord. And Lord, open our hearts that we will receive a word from you that will bless us, dear God, that will restore and energize us, dear God, to go out to serve, dear God, Lord, and to be a witness to others. In Jesus' name, we give you the honor and glory. Amen.
Good morning.
Morning.
It's good to be back in the house of God. We sang this morning, this is God's house, God's place. It's not God's house because it's built in a certain construction, and it's not God's house because of its history or anything else. It's God's house because God's people get together here.
Amen.
And everywhere where even two or three gather together, that's the house of God. I want to add one other word of testimony to our prayer, and another thing for us to pray for. Make sure we pray this week for our 4-H'ers who are going to camp. Some of them are leaving this afternoon. They'll be gone until next Saturday, and so that's part of why our numbers are a little bit fewer today. We are joined, however, by some friends online, and so welcome to each one there. We're going to get into the scripture here. Pretty quickly, and we're going to see what we can see about this very familiar passage of Scripture. I'd like you to pray for me that my voice will hold out. I've been doing pretty well, but I want to make sure we get this all done. Now, Jesus taught in parables, and all three of the Synoptic Gospels introduce his body of teaching in parables with this parable of the sower that we're going to be taking a look at. So let's just take a minute to think about what a parable is. It's not a word we use much outside of this context anymore. Parable is a story that is told with a point to it that goes beyond the story. The parables of the kingdom of God tell us something about the kingdom of God by using familiar images to bring something to our mind, but the parable is never about itself. Jesus is describing what a farmer does, but he's not really teaching us about farming. He's teaching us about something else. In fact, in Mark's version of this gospel, when he goes to explain this, when he says, if you don't understand this parable, how will you understand any of the parables? So there is something in this particular story that gives us keys to unlock what a lot of the other stories are about. And these stories are about the impact of the Word of God on our lives and how we can most benefit from what God has to say to us. So I think I put on the screen where it says, what I've called key verses for this understanding. First of all, let anyone with ears to hear listen. He who has ears, let him hear. He says that over and over again. And secondly, pay attention to what you hear, or maybe to how you hear. So this is going to be a parable about how we hear the Word of God. Okay. Now, the thing about God is you don't see him with your eyes, right? Yeah. The thing about spiritual things is they're not visible like, you know, wood and cloth and skin and all of these things, this physical world we live in. They're something that you have to look for with a different organ of perception than our sensory organs in order to understand who God is. And our way of perceiving God's presence in our lives is something we call faith. And so Jesus is teaching us about what faith is. He wants us to understand that because, he says to his disciples, blessed are your eyes for they see, and your ears for they hear. After talking about how easy it is for someone to hear without hearing and perceive without understanding. And he says, many of those who gathered around him were not really hearing what he had to say. So So we want to make sure we're not in that group of people, but we want to be in the group of people who do get the blessing of hearing and understanding. So let's go through this just sort of quickly, line by line, and look at the elements of this, and then I'm going to have a few more things to say. We're going to kind of go through this a couple of times. First of all, now, the first thing he says, when anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart, and that's what's sown on the path. So the picture here is the farmer is casting the seed, broadcasting the seed, and some of it falls on the hard ground. The hard ground is the path, and it doesn't get penetrated by the word because it's hard. Okay? If you've got, well, we're going to get into that in a minute. This is hearing without understanding. Somebody, you know, they might hear you quote a Bible verse, they might have been to church and listened to a sermon, but they didn't really get what it was about. They might have even read the Bible, but they didn't do it in a way that it got to them purposely. Then the next category of person is the rocky ground. And this is the person who has a little bit of soil available. It gets into them. They understand a little bit. They get it that this is good news. They receive it with joy, but the ground has got stones in it, and the good soil is shallow and it doesn't have room to take root. And so whenever any difficulty comes up, they fall away. Third thing is the thorns. Pretty straightforward. That's the one who hears the word. The cares of the world and the lures of wealth choke the word, and it yields nothing. And then finally, he talks about the good soil, which brings forth grain, and that's fruitful soil, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. And that's the person who hears the word and understands it, and who indeed bears fruit. So let's take a look at what this is about. The ground is the heart. Your heart. Okay. I said last week when we went over this briefly that this story is not about trying to divide people into categories, about looking around you at people in the world and saying, okay, those folks, this category of persons, this group of people that I can identify and point my finger at, those are all rocky ground. They'll never understand the word of God, and they might as well not bother with it. That's not what he said. Okay. If we hear it that way, we're hearing it wrong. Okay. If we look at somebody and say, those people are shallow, they're not going to get it, they're not going to really follow God when times get worse tough, and we write them off, then we're still not hearing the word of God ourselves. And it goes like that. What do you do with each type of ground? How is your heart? That's the question we want to ask. Because we are to prepare the soil for ourselves to hear the word of God. That's you and me, each one of us, and that's all the time.
Amen.
So, what do we need to do to prepare the soil? First, understand the word. Understand what Jesus says to us. Understand what God's message is to us. The path of the hard ground of the path is a place where that is literally downtrodden. So here's the first thing. Don't let anybody tread on you. Don't allow the circumstances of your life to beat you down and harden your heart, because then all you're going to feel is a need to defend yourself, and you won't be able to receive any good news from God because you're too busy just trying to hold on to whatever you have or don't have. So that first kind of ground is that hard ground that is hard because it's been packed down and there's no room for anything new to come into it. There's no room for understanding. So in order to get some understanding, we need to soften our heart a little bit. Need to hear Jesus' invitation when he says, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden," as we talked about last week. And here we have, cast your care on him because he cares for you. Don't worry, pray. Okay, seek wisdom from God. If anyone lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, and it will be given to him. He gives to all men freely, without rebuke. God's highest wisdom, I'll say this here because you'll hear it from me all the time, God's highest wisdom is love. And this is the key that will unlock everything. So first thing is, and if we're bringing this word to somebody else, and we want to help them get an understanding so that they don't be in this category of people with a hard heart, then maybe we need to take some action to also help them get somebody else's boots off their path. So we need to lift people up. We need to liberate one another. And we need to make sure that we are able to stand and not let somebody walk all over us. Okay, secondly, the rocky ground is ready to hear, but there are things that get in the way. When I was a kid, we had a vegetable garden back on the farm. And every spring, I don't care how good the garden was last year, every spring we had to go out, and over the course of the winter, some rocks had sprouted up in that garden. I don't know how that happens, but we had to go out and pick up rocks from the garden and move them to the side. We had to get those hard things out so that when we planted our peas and corn and carrots and beans and whatever, they would have a place to grow because those rocks would prevent them from growing. So in the winter seasons of your life, hard things can come up as if from nowhere into your life. These might be small sins. Bits of resentment, a bitter root. Somewhere it says, "Let's take care lest there spring up among you a bitter root." Okay. Those things need to be rooted out. We used to sometimes have to take a shovel because one of these rocks would come up and be so big we couldn't pick it up by hand. Amen. Okay. Confessing and forsaking sin, even for those of us who've been in this for a while, that might take some time.
Amen.
It might take some effort. It might take some paying attention. But it's necessary for the good seed of God's word to take root in you.
Amen.
Okay. Because other than that, what happens is you've got somebody who hears something on the surface. They understand it a bit with their mind. They get, maybe they memorize some verses. They get some things. But it doesn't go very far into their heart because there are these hard things that are in the way. So we're cultivating the soil.
Amen.
Third thing is the thorns. Jesus clearly identifies these as the cares of the world and the lure or the deceitfulness of wealth, which choke the word and make it unfruitful. So here's the thing. This is for us to hear. In the United States of America, this is not a very popular message, but guess what? In the kingdom of God, our own comfort, our own advancement, even our own survival is not our first priority. Jesus does say somewhere that your Father knows that your needs, which must be met daily. But what does he say? He says, "Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you." If we make it, this is the thing that trips up Christian people a lot. If we make our first priority our own benefit, so that we make sure that somebody's not mistreating us, so that we make sure that we get ahead, so that we make sure that we get what belongs to us, so we make sure that we advance ahead of somebody else, so that we make sure we get enough comfort, enough wealth. The gospel of wealth is as American as apple pie. But what's going to happen is we become crowded with all of these concerns, and the Word of God has no place to come in. And he says we become unfruitful. Now, fruit, remember the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, meekness, faithfulness, self-control, against all these things there is no law. We become unfruitful in that we cease to be producing out in the world around us those things. We cease to be multiplying in our own setting the image of God as revealed in Jesus Christ. We become unfruitful because our priorities are with the thorns, the things that want to draw attention to themselves, our comfort, our survival, our advancement. Jesus says, if anyone wants to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily and follow me. Whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake, the same will find it. I mean, that's consistent in his teaching, that if we put ourselves first, we're going to be last. Paul says somewhere, just to show that we're here throughout the New Testament, godliness with contentment is great gain.
Amen.
It's a good discipline to practice contentment, practice being satisfied with what God has given you today, giving thanks for what you have, not worrying and complaining about what you don't have yet. The richest man in the world apparently was an unhappy man, John D. Rockefeller, when somebody asked him how much money is enough, and he said, just a little more. Paul says, as I said, that godliness with contentment is great gain, and he warns us against those who suppose that gain is godliness. And there is a way of thinking that says, if God has blessed you, he's blessed you with money, he's blessed you with comfort, he's blessed you with possessions, he's blessed you with wealth, as if those things are evidence of God's blessing. And if you're poor, God has not blessed you. I'm telling you, that is a sinful way of thinking. Because Jesus said, blessed are you poor. Look at it up in the Gospel of Luke. He said it that way. In Matthew it says, poor in spirit. And in Luke he says, blessed are you poor, for yours is the kingdom of heaven. Woe to you who are rich. He says that in so many words. That's Jesus. We got to hear his word. The gospel of wealth is a real spiritual danger in our place where we live right now. And that's whether you're rich, whether you're poor, or whether you're somewhere in between. Because the lure of wealth is the thing that drives so much of our thinking. It's the thing that drives so much of our resentment and causes those stones to build up. And all of these things are related. So let's get to the last point. Good soil is the result of cultivation. Most farmers, I think, and you can check me on this, will tell you that it's not likely that you're just going to find good soil out there waiting for you. If you just go out and throw your seed around, you're going to find one of these other few things. And in order to get the good soil, you got to do some work and you got to do some preparation. We break up the hard ground. We dig into those things that keep us feeling solid and safe and comfortable so that no new idea can get into our mind. We remove the rocks. We deal with those things in ourselves where bitterness or resentment or anger or all of those things that are not of the Spirit of God are allowed to form, like those rocks in the garden that show up in the spring. We weed out the thorns. We check ourselves when we begin to put priority on the wrong things. And once we've done those things, now we are ready to listen to Jesus. to hear the Word of God. And you know what? When you really hear the Word of God, you become, as James says, not only hearers, but doers of the Word, because we begin to act in accordance with the things that He teaches us.
Amen.
I want us to be fruitful. I want us to be fruitful in producing those things which are indicated as the fruit of the Spirit in our own lives. The fruit of the Spirit, by the way, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, meekness, faithfulness, self-control. These are not just good feelings that we're to possess within ourselves. Oh, I've got some nice love. I got joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Well, let's express some joy around, shall we?
Amen.
I've got peace like a river. Let's do some hard work of making peace in the world. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. See, we privatize all of these things. But for the fruit of the Spirit to be fruitful, you know what happens when something is fruitful? It just shows up everywhere. It takes over. 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold. You can't hide it.
Amen.
My lawn is awfully fruitful now, and I need to cut the grass again. I know. Or I'm going to get choked with weeds and thorns pretty quick. But in order to be fruitful, we need to cultivate the ground. We need to weed out the hard things. We need to weed out the things that are the wrong priority. And then the other way of being fruitful is not just by producing love, joy, peace, patience, gentleness. Oh, how this world needs some gentleness today.
Amen.
Goodness. Meekness, that means humility. Faithfulness and self-control. All of these things that are necessary for us to live the life that we're called upon to live. Available to us from the Spirit of God. The other way in which we can be fruitful is by multiplying. Amen. By infecting someone else with God's holiness.
Amen.
You know, we're called upon not to be defenders of a shrinking and dwindling faith, but to be ambassadors for a good news that's supposed to take over the world.
Amen.
And that means we infect somebody else with love. We infect somebody else with joy. We influence the world with peace.
Amen.
We practice long-suffering, which is patience. And everybody makes a joke out of that and says, oh, don't ask for patience because you're going to get trouble. Well, okay, maybe you need some trouble because God wants you to develop some patience. But what's going to do is it's going to produce, as those things become characteristic of you, they will also become characteristic of people in your circle and people you touch. And you're going to see somebody's life transform. Just because you set aside those hard things and put them outside your garden. Just because you weeded out those thorns and you weren't afraid to get a little stickers in your hand when you did it. You reset your priorities. Just because you dug deep into your own heart to get past where somebody has hurt you too many times. So you can be soft and tender enough to receive what Jesus has to say to you. The end result is the kingdom of God. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Because this word he's teaching in these parables is the word of the kingdom.
Amen.
That's our priority. That's what we are supposed to seek first, as it says up in the sign. We seek first the kingdom. And all these things will be yours as well. We're going to close with a song that Shannon taught us quite a little while ago. It's putting to music a passage from Isaiah. You shall go up with joy and be led forth with peace. The mountains and the hills will break forth before you. There will be shouts of joy, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. So we're going to go out with joy.
shouts of joy, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. And all the trees of the field will clap their hands. And the trees of the field will clap their hands. The trees of the field will clap their hands. And you grow up with joy. Out with joy, and be led forth with peace. The mountains and the hills will break forth before you. There'll be shouts of joy, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. And all the trees of the field will clap their hands. The trees of the field will clap their hands. The trees of the field will clap their hands. Will you go out with joy?
Thank you, Lord, for the teaching of our Savior Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord, that you have put something in our hearts, the imperishable living Word of God. And thank you that this will overtake the world, bring joy, bring peace, bring love, bring all the things that this world needs so desperately. May it begin here, in me, in us, and in all your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
May the Lord bless and keep you in his care as you leave this place. Take his love.